Morning. It's good to be with you once again this morning. Welcome to those of you watching online. Just one announcement. This is my last Sunday covering for Rob. So next Sunday you can look forward to Pastor Rob being up here leading again. I thank you for the opportunity, and it's been an honor preaching for you these past 3 months, and I look forward to still filling in for Rob off and on. For the time being, at least. With that, just please stand and just greet one another. Remain standing for the call to worship. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Let us open with prayer, and we're going to do a prayer of confession as well. Oh Lord, most wonderful, awesome, and awe-inspiring God. Lord, we come humbly before you this morning. We come in a time of worship to you. So Lord, we just ask that you send your Spirit to dwell in and among us. Lord, just may we just feel your presence here today as we worship you. Lord, we just ask that you be with each and every one of us. Be with those watching online as well. Lord, give strength, health, and safety. And Lord, we pray now for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, we come before you silently to confess our sins. Lord, hear our prayers. Hear our confessions. And Lord, forgive us of those sins. Lord, we trust in you. We submit ourselves to you, knowing that Christ has come and that he has died that we can be forgiven. So Lord, we give you praise for that. And we thank you for that this morning. Lord, we just ask once again your blessing this morning. In all that we do, may we just honor and praise your name. In the name of your Son, for Christ's sake alone, Amen. This morning we're going to sing two praise songs, one right after the other. The first is "Here I Am to Worship," and the second is "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." So let us sing.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say, together wonderful to me.
you're still our ancient foe. Doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing.
Be seated this morning. I'd like to invite Elle up for the children's message, and the children can come forward as well.
All right, I need a hand this morning. Who wants to help me? Jada, can you spell? Can you help me with some words? Pretty simple word. We're going to talk about sin today. Can you write that on here? If I help you. Write S. I. N. Okay. Now, this is my favorite whiteboard. I use this a lot. I write notes to myself because I forget things a lot, so it stays on my fridge at home, so I write words on there. And Jada wrote the word sin on here, and that's something that comes in our lives and kind of gets between us, but this board's not clean anymore, is it? It's kind of dirty, isn't it? So I want you to wipe that off for me. And when you do that, I want you to think pure thoughts, okay? Maybe like obeying your mom and dad, maybe helping grandma out or something like that. And while she does that, and this board is now clean, whoa. You're not trying. Let's think. Pure thoughts. Let's think about helping somebody across the street, maybe picking up your room. Let's wipe that off there. While Jada does that, and you know, I'm sure that she'll get that off of there, and let's see.
Do you Sharpie on it?
It's still on there. Still didn't go away. What pin did you? Oh no. That says a permanent marker. Wow. That's it. My board is ruined. I'll never be able to get that word off of there, will I? There's nothing that I'm going to be able to do that, or is there? Is there something we can do? There is, yeah. Should we try putting some little water on there? Let's see if that gets that off of there. Here, let me put a little water on there. Okay, now I'm sure Jada's going to get that off of there, and while she does that, we'll move on a little bit more. Whoa, it still didn't come off. Now, I don't know what's going on here today, but I don't think that permanent marker is going to get that sin out of there, is it? You think is there something else that we can do, maybe? How about Jesus? If the Bible says the blood of Jesus washes us clean and makes us new again. So, I got another marker here. And now I would just want you to take this marker and just cover them words. Cover them all up. And if we use this as the blood of Christ, and when that happens, sin is all gone. Isn't that pretty neat? That the blood of Christ washes us clean and makes us new again. So thank you, Jada. You didn't ruin my board. It just took some little extra effort there to get that done. So just remember that there's no sin that we can do that God will never forgive us for. All we got to do is ask for forgiveness, and God will do that for us. Okay? Let's have a word of prayer. Dear God, we just thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the blood he shed on the cross for us and what it means to every one of us. And we just thank you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you, Al, for some excellent imagery again this morning. You always do a good job. This morning, I'd like you to turn to Ephesians 6, and we're going to read verse 10 through the end of the chapter, verse 24. We're going to focus mostly on 10 through 20, but just finish out the chapter this morning. Let us read together. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against the flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, and with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me, so I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Tychicus, this dear brother and faithful servant in the Lord, will tell you everything so that you also may know how I am and what I am doing. I am sending him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage you. Peace to the brothers and sisters and love with faith from God and the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. The reading of the word of the Lord. Let us pray. O Lord, most wonderful and awesome God, Lord, we have heard and read your word this morning. Lord, may you just lay these words on our hearts. Give us a renewed strength and renewed courage in you this morning. Lord, be with me as I present this message, and Lord, may your Spirit work in and through me and work in the hearts of all who hear. Lord, may these be your words and not mine. So bless us once again this morning. In thy name we pray, for Christ's sake. Amen. As I begin to look at the armor of God this morning, it's very evident that one sermon cannot do justice to this. I know that in the past, Pastor Rob has done a series on the armor, and that is much more effective. But I want to kind of get the full scope of it today, kind of to finish out Ephesians, and since it's my last sermon here for a while again. So I'm just going to kind of give us a little bit of a look at each piece of armor, and then just kind of the full scope of what Paul is calling us to this morning. So this morning, Paul once again gives us some instruction for how we are to live our lives. But instead of focusing on obedience, submission, and humble service, as we've seen last week, he instead focuses on the strength that we have in Christ. He says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Paul gives a battle cry against the evils of this world. This seems like a totally different way of following Christ, but it goes hand in hand with loving and serving our neighbors. Part of sharing Christ's love is speaking out against evil and corrupt beliefs. Paul is calling us to stand, take action against Satan and those who do Satan's work in this world. Whether we like to think about it or not, we live in a world that is constantly trying to persuade us to give in to Satan's power and ways. And if we take a step back, it's very easy to see which things are for God and which things are from Satan. Everything that Satan promotes in this world leads to death and destruction. I've put together a short list of some of the many things that are going on today that we can see how Satan works. The tearing apart, the division of people. That's how he works. Through abortion, human trafficking, rioting, looting. The trying to get rid of law and order. Racism. Pushing irrational fear and division. Sexual immorality. Hatred. These things are from Satan. They are his work. In contrast, we have the things that Christ promotes. The things that Christ promotes leads to life and renewal, such as the sanctity of human life, equality of all humans, mission and outreach, caring for our neighbors, love and respect for others, faith, hope, and love. These things are from God. They're part of God's work. Now, I could add a lot more to both of these lists. There's a lot more stuff going on out there. We know that. But what I really wanted is just to give us a little picture today. Can you see the contrast? But now for the real difficulty. How can we help? What do we do? If you're like me, you see the news headlines and you think, man, the world is so evil. It's scary. It's scary to even try to make a difference. You speak out on something and you're attacked for it. But we're called to take a stand. That's what Paul is calling us to. We cannot be lukewarm Christians who let Satan walk all over us. That's not how we're called to live. So what can we do? What tools do we have? And Paul gives us some vital information about the tools that we need to fight against the powers of evil in this world. He uses the powerful imagery of soldiers in armor to reinforce the idea of battle. They must go into battle. And this was a powerful imagery for especially those 2,000 years ago because they had the heavy armor. Now, I know our soldiers dress much differently today than they did 2,000 years ago. But the idea is still the same. But I actually would like to go a little bit different route this morning. I want to use a little bit different imagery because it means something to me personally. As many of you know, I'm on the volunteer fire department here in Inwood. And as I was reading Paul's description of armor, the armor of God, I immediately felt and thought about the protective equipment that we use as firefighters. I'm sure many of you are familiar with the firefighter's uniform and some of the tools that we use. Either you've seen it or you've used it at one point in your lives. So you can understand how essential this protective equipment is for those who are fighting fires. So first, Paul says we must have the belt of truth buckled around our waist. Now, when I thought of the belt of truth, I thought of our SCBA, our air packs. And you look at the picture this morning, you can see the air pack And it's belted, buckled over your shoulders, you have a belt around your waist, and it goes to your regulator up front for your mask. And the reason I thought about the air pack is because the air pack is God's revealed truth to us as Christians. The truth we can rely on. When we get into difficult situations where Satan is trying to twist the truth, and it's difficult for us to breathe, we can take a fresh breath of air from God's truth. We can rely on that truth to be there for us. Same way with our air pack. We can breathe in clean air. It allows us to renew and reminds us we can rely on God and His truth, and we don't waver from that. And in the same way that firefighters have to refill their air packs after a fire, it's important that we also, as Christians, continually refill ourselves on God's word, on those truths. Go back to those truths that we can rely on. Read your Bible. So the next time you can be ready for the next difficult situation where someone is trying to twist that truth or deny that truth, you have that, you're able to rely on those truths. They're ready. So that's the first tool that we have. Next, we have the breastplate of righteousness. Now to me, this is the firefighter's uniform, the coat, pants, and hood, and so on. If we put our uniform on correctly, we can rely on our uniform to protect us from being burned or cut or get wet and frozen during the winter. It also helps others to see us and recognize us as firefighters. The same way with righteousness. Righteousness is a gift from God. It helps us to defend against the attacks of Satan and evil people. Those attacks bounce off us because we are righteous, we're upright. We're doing the right things. And it also helps others to recognize us as Christians. Helps others to see us as someone they can rely on because of our righteousness. Because we're a Christian who seeks to do the right thing. So that's another gift of God. He gives us righteousness. Next, we must have our feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. This is represented by our fire boots. These boots are specially made to be ready for anything. They're fireproof, waterproof, steel-toed, steel plates on the bottom. With these boots, firefighters can be confident and intentional about walking into difficult situations, knowing that they're protected. They don't have to move too quickly because don't have to be afraid of being burnt or stepping on broken glass or nails. In the same way, the gospel of peace allows us to be ready at all times. Be ready to walk into difficult situations. We can also turn to the gospel of peace to bring hope, to remind us of what Christ has done, of Christ's sacrificial love for His people. This gospel gives us a place to stand. Because Christ is the solid rock on which we stand. We can rely on Christ no matter what. And also the gospel of peace We can see Christ's example of how he dealt with tough situations and how he was always ready to share his love in a peaceful way with those who are in need of it. That gospel of peace just gives us that readiness, because we're sure, we're confident in Christ. We can be, because Christ has proven himself over and over again. Next, Paul points to the shield of faith. This to me is the fire hose. Firefighters often use the hose as a shield to protect themselves and others from flames or to cool down an area. We're taught to put the fire hose on wide span, and it instantly cools down the area. It's a shield. And our faith is much like this. We as Christians can rely on our faith in God in times of trouble. When something happens in our life, our faith in God protects us from the heat and flames that Satan attacks us with in an effort to cause us to stumble. Our faith in God will get us through some of the worst and most trying times in our lives. Just like a hose will help a firefighter get through some of the worst conditions they will ever face, we must always hold on to our faith in tough times. And sometimes that's a hard thing to do, right? Our faith can be shaken. But we must never let go of it. Just as you don't want to lose your shield in battle, you don't want to lose your hose in a fire. You want to hold on to your faith, because faith will get you through. Next, we have the helmet of salvation. The firefighter's helmet is used to protect their head, their brains. It can be the difference between life and death. In the same way that salvation is the difference between spiritual life and spiritual death. Without salvation, we are destined to an eternity without God, without hope. As you can imagine, going through life without hope is difficult. You ask any firefighter, they will tell you by no means will they ever go into a structure fire without their helmet on. The helmet completes the firefighter's uniform. Without a helmet, the rest of the uniform is almost useless. Just the same way, we cannot go into battle with Satan without the assurance of our salvation. Without salvation through Christ, we don't have anything to have faith in. The gospel of peace would not exist. Righteousness would be unattainable. Salvation is the ultimate gift from God. It's what we need to pray for. We need to thank God for Christ providing a way of salvation. Because everything else stems from that. So if we're going to go into battle against Satan, as we're called to do, we need to have our helmet of salvation on. If you're wearing your helmet of salvation, you can point out to someone else and say, hey, put your helmet on. Right? You can reach out. Show how important it is to wear our helmet of salvation. And finally, we have the sword of the Spirit. Or as I like to think of, the firefighter's axe. The firefighter's axe is used in times when force is needed. When a door or window is stuck, or to provide ventilation to a roof or wall. In the same way, the sword of the Spirit or the axe represents the Word of God. It can be used in the same way to push back against the enemy in battle, to weaken the fire as we battle to put it out. This is another way to use God's Word. As we have seen in the first place, it can be used as the belt of truth or the air pack that we can go back to and rely on to renew us in tough times. But now Paul shows us that we can use it as a weapon to fight against the evil one. Remember, Satan knows the truth. Even evil people have a conscience. Deep down within, they know what's wrong. Appeal to that. Use God's word to show the error of other people's ways. Or to show the error of our own ways. To bring us back to humble humility. We can ask for forgiveness and repent of our sins. Sometimes we need to just take up the axe, the Word of God, and push forward, push back against Satan. Not to be afraid and run away. So we see that God's word is not only for personal strength and renewal, it's also for outreach and correction for those who are battling against us and battling against God's word. Paul finishes by telling us that we must pray in the Spirit on all occasions. This is extremely important for us to remember as we go out into the world and battle against Satan and his demons. We need to pray constantly for God's people, for ourselves, our leaders, our nation, and even our enemies. Pray for our enemies. It doesn't mean join them, doesn't mean be friends with them. They're still our enemies. They're still against God. We can pray for them. Pray for the turning of their hearts. Pray for repentance. Pray for the Holy Spirit to show them the evilness of their ways. We live in an evil world that seeks to destroy us in many ways. All we have to do is look at the news, and we can plainly see the death and destruction that Satan and his followers are actively and purposefully leaving behind them. If we as Christians stood up against evil people with the same passion that evil people are standing against us, it would not be a fair fight. Am I right? We know that Christ has already won the war. But with God on our side and the proper attire, with that armor, we can actively fight the battle, fight the fire. And while we're fighting the fire, we can save some of those who are trapped inside through Christ. So keep praying. I urge you. Keep praying and get dressed for battle. Because the world is evil. And Satan really isn't even trying to hide anymore. We can plainly see many of what Paul calls the devil's schemes taking place in our nation and through the world today. And in the words of Christ, he says, "Whoever is not with me is against me. Whoever does not gather with me scatters." We don't get the choice to stand on the sidelines and not pick a side on matters. As Christians, we are called to stand up for what is right and true. This is obvious if we read Scripture and study Jesus' time on earth. We must do it with compassion and love for everyone. But we must stand firmly in Christ. We must put on our proper attire, our battle clothing, that righteousness, truth, and so on. We must be ready. Lean on Christ, study the gospel, and pray always. And be ready. Be ready at all times. Amen? Let us pray. Oh Lord, God Almighty, Lord, we are humbled once again, knowing that we are your servants. Lord, that you call us into battle. You call us to stand for what is right. So Lord, I just pray that you work in us, that you send your Holy Spirit to just give us that strength that we need, to show us what we must do, and that we make the most of every opportunity to share your love and your truths, Lord. So Lord, we rely on you for strength, for protection, and for compassion, Lord. But we know and understand that you call us to go forward and to be ready. So Lord, help us to do that. In thy name we pray, for Christ's sake. Amen. Please remain seated as we sing the song, "Your Love Defends Me."
You are my joy, you are my song, you are the way, the one I'm drawing from, you are my refuge, fills me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me. Your love defends me. Surely my God is the strength of my soul. Your love defends me. Your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me. Your love defends me. We sing hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation. Hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation. Hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation.
We now come into a time of offertory prayer. Just once again, continue to remind you to keep giving back to the Lord for all the wonderful things He has done for us. Let us just pray over the offering this morning. O Lord, God Almighty, Lord, we come before You. We give back to You, Lord, knowing that all we have is Yours. That everything that we possess is from You. So, Lord, we give back to You a small portion of what has been given to us. And, Lord, we pray that You may use it to just continue Your work in this world. That You may expand Your kingdom through these gifts. Lord, we pray for wisdom for the deacons as they discern where these gifts must go. So Lord, we just ask that Your Holy Spirit dwells in them as well. So Lord, I just ask that You bless these gifts this morning and may You just bless the givers. In Thy name we pray, for Christ's sake. Amen. As we come into a time of morning prayer this morning, congratulations to Travis and Brittany Van Otterloo in the birth of their daughter, Harper Jade. So praise God for new life and for good health. They're doing well. So also would like to highlight that Jesse and Melissa Mosier will be going in this week. Melissa has another set of scans, of MRIs. To reassess the size and location of the tumors. So just pray specifically that those tumors have not grown or moved. And it'd be wonderful if they shrank a little. But just pray specifically for that and for minimal pain during the MRIs for Melissa as well. And just keep them in your prayers. I believe they go in tomorrow. That's what I heard through the grapevine, so appreciate their prayers for them as well. Also, just continue to pray for Pastor Rob as he's coming back from sabbatical. It's going to be kind of a transition back into ministry for him, and so just pray for strength and for wisdom for Rob, and I know that this sabbatical has been really good for him, but I think he's ready to come back, so, and I think we're all looking forward to it as well, so pray for him, and of course, keep Sarah Krupke in your prayers as well. I don't have any new information on her at this time. Justin Brower has still been struggling greatly. He's been having a lot of neck and head pain again, So I believe he's actually going in for MRI tomorrow to see once if there's something else going on as well. So just continue to pray for him. It's kind of frustrating for him, I know, because it was getting so much better, and now it's kind of dipped worse again. So part of it, he said that the doctor in Wisconsin said that it could get kind of worse again at the end, and then it will be gone. So they're praying that's what it is, but they don't know for sure what's going on. So he said that he has trouble even standing up when he gets out of the couch and stuff. It kind of feels like he's going to fall over. So pray for him. And then just continue to pray for everyone with their cancer treatments. Suzanne Meandring is also been added to our list again. I know she's been not been doing very well lately again, so just continue to pray for her as well. With that, let us pray. Oh Lord, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you lifting the needs and cares of our congregation and community to you, Lord. Lord, we give you praise this morning for new life and the birth of Harper Jade. Lord, we just thank you for good health for both mother and child. So Lord, we just ask that you draw close to this family, and Lord, may they just continue to rely on you, and Lord, just may Harper grow in strength and health, Lord. Lord, we pray too for Melissa Mosier. Lord, as we know that she goes in again for some more MRIs and some tests, Lord, we just ask, Lord, we pray specifically that these tumors have not moved or grown. Lord, we just pray for peace for Melissa and for Jesse and their family. Lord, may you just draw close to them. Lord, we just ask that you give them the strength that they need. Lord, we pray too that there is little to no pain during the MRIs, Lord. And may you just wrap your arms around this family. Lord, we pray too for Sarah Krupke. Lord, we just ask that you continue to draw close to her, bring peace and patience as they continue to go through the testing processes. Lord, just keep them, uphold them, and lead them as they go through this process. Lord, we pray too for Justin, and we pray for Carrie and his family, Lord. We just ask that you draw close to them as well as, Lord, there's been a relapse. And Lord, we know that it's hard. But Lord, we just continue to pray that they continue to rely on you. Lord, we have faith in you, even in the tough times. Lord, we know that you are in control and you have a plan. And Lord, we pray for health and for strength for Justin. And Lord, we just pray that whatever is going on is merely a side effect, Lord, that it will go away quickly. Lord, we pray for continual healing. Lord, we pray for all those who are receiving treatment for cancer. Lord, we think of Melissa Mosier and Trish Lombard, for Suzanne Meandring, Lord, and for Les Vanderlucht, and for Brent, and for Bruce, and others, Lord. We just continue to lift them up to you. May you give strength. May you give healing. And may you give peace. So Lord, just lead, guide, and protect them. Lord, we pray too for Pastor Rob as he comes back from sabbatical. Lord, we pray for Dory as well and their family. Lord, as this will be another life transition for them. Lord, may you just draw close to them, give wisdom, give strength, and may your Spirit guide and protect them. Lord, we think of the schools going back. Lord, as many start tomorrow, some have already started. Lord, we just ask that you draw close to the staff and to the students. Lord, may you give protection. May you give health, strength, and may you calm any fears that there are. Lord, we just continue to lift them up to you as they go forward with the learning process. May this be a somewhat normal year, Lord. Lord, we pray too for our nation, for our leaders. Lord, we just ask that you draw close to them, that they may turn to you, Lord. We pray for those who are rising up against you, Lord. Those who seek to destroy. Those who are filled with evil and are following Satan's patterns. Lord, we just ask that you may reveal your power to them in a great way. And Lord, we pray that we as the church, as the body of Christ, may reach out. That we may fearlessly preach your word. Share your love and guidance with others. So Lord, we just ask that you draw close to us as well. We pray for those who have unspoken prayer requests this morning. Lord, may you draw close to each and every one of them. May you provide for their needs, whether it be emotional, physical, mental, financial, Lord, or any other need that they may have. Lord, may they just turn to you. We ask for your continued provision. Lord, we pray all these things in your most holy name, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please rise for the benediction. And now to the one who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine. To him be the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We'll close by singing My Lighthouse.
Troubled sea, whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. to shore, safe to shore. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore.